button. I had to have Val help me. Not used to doing this. Good morning and welcome to church. We're so excited to have you here. Remember to fill out your attendance slip, the blue slip that comes in your bulletin. And welcome to everyone who's here, who's in TV, who's online. Thank you for joining us for worship this morning. I appreciate it. If you're a guest this morning, I don't see any guests, but if you are a guest, be sure and visit our Welcome Center out in the lobby. We would appreciate that. Let's see. Carol Perry wanted me to mention, if you are waiting for a picture of Sig and Beth, it will be on the table outside the office. Also, they are having a cookie bake and exchange for the firefighters. All this information is in your grace notes. This is the outreach missions. They're going to meet on Saturday, July 23rd. And there's a sign up outside the office. All the details are in grace notes, so go there to get it. And Miss Joanne, do we have a video this morning? Okay, we have a video from VBS, so if you would watch the screen, you get to see how much fun we had with those kiddos. If you would all stand and greet each other with the love of Christ, let's greet each other now. Thank you, and what a wonderful video. Thank you, Carol. Oh. worship so well. Thank you all. If you would all stand as you're able this morning for our call to worship. Thank you. Let us call upon the Lord, and he will answer us.
In the evening, in the morning, and at the noonday, we call out to him, and he hears our voice.
The Lord, who is enthroned as King from eternity to eternity, will hear and answer when we call. Let us worship him. Let us continue our worship with Sweet Hour of Prayer, UMH number 496, and on the screen. Seated. Our hearts go out this week to the family of Bill Robinson. His funeral was this past week, as I'm sure you all know. And what a wonder for him to be able to go to his Heavenly Father. We all praise God for that. We know Bill was a man of faith, and to be reunited with his beloved Marjorie is such a wonderful thing to contemplate. If you would like, you may join us here at the rail for our congregational prayer. We will have a moment of personal prayer time, and then we will have our congregational prayer. Thank you. These sweet moments of prayer, grateful that you desire to hear our voices call out to you. We praise you, Lord Jesus, for opening the way for us to speak with the one who created us. We are humbled, Holy Spirit, that you would take our faltering words and interpret them to the ear of our Heavenly Father, making our prayers useful for the sake of his eternal kingdom.
How good and gracious you are to us, O God of the open ear.
Teach us, Holy Spirit, to live by prayer as well as by your providence for ourselves, our souls, our bodies, our children, family, and church. Give us hearts pliable in your hand, willing to conform to your will. Help us recognize the sin that accompanies us through our days and to celebrate the good you are able to distill from the works of our hands.
Let our work of prayer bring our will in line with yours, for without it, our praying would be folly.
Forgive us, Lord, when in our prayers we seek to command, to set ourselves above you, to consider ourselves wiser, for that is our sin and pride. Keep our prayers according to your precepts and your promises so that your will may be done in us and through us for your glory.
We hear your command to pray throughout your word and ask for your help. Guide our prayers and teach us to pray in the love of Jesus, our Redeemer.
We hold before your throne of mercy and grace all rulers and authorities in this world, especially our president, his administration, our senators and representatives, our judges, and our military.
We pray for leaders in our community, for teachers, first responders, medical professionals, our churches, and our city government.
We know you see the needs in this world and are confident that you have the power to set right that which is skewed, to mend that which is broken, and to restore that which has been damaged beyond recognition, including the image of Jesus in the souls of humankind.
How good and gracious you are to us, O God of the open ear. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I do love that song. If you would all stand as you're able for our hymn of preparation, Near to the Heart of God, number 472.
Yeah. Thank you for standing for the Word of God. Today's scripture comes from 1 Thessalonians 5:17. It says, "Pray without ceasing." This is the Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. Well, good morning, Grace Church. I'm back to share God's word with you today. I'm so excited to do so, and I just pray that what the Lord has placed on my heart will be a blessing to each of you. My parents came today, and my son, to hear what the Lord had laid on my heart. And when my parents got out of the car, I said, "Well, thank goodness I didn't write anything about you." I'm not going to rat them out on anything. They're safe. Now, I am not going to say the same for my son. I may rat him a little bit. But let's open in prayer so we know that the Holy Spirit is leading what I say and that your hearts are prepared for the Lord. So, Heavenly Gracious Father, I thank you so much for what you have placed in my heart. Lord, I pray that you would speak through me, Lord Jesus, that these words would not be my words, but they would be yours. I pray for those who need to hear from you today, Lord, that you're already stirring in their hearts, preparing that soil, Lord, and that they can take this and that you can do a work in their life. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, by the songs, hopefully you know what I may be preaching on today. Today I'm sharing on prayer. What does your prayer life look like? If you were to sit down and really think about it, what would you say your prayer life looks like? What would others say about your prayer life? Would the Holy Spirit instantly convict your heart when that question is asked, thinking, maybe I have some work to do? Or maybe you're saying, I love my prayer life. I hear from him, he leads me, he guides me, he convicts me, and he changes me. We have a close relationship. If someone asked you, do you pray as the scripture says, without ceasing, how would you answer? And maybe you don't know what the word means. Maybe you have a prayer closet. I don't know if you guys have seen the movie War Room, but it is an anointed movie. If you haven't seen it, I would say go rent it, buy it, add it to your collection. But this is someone who is taking prayer seriously. They have their scriptures written out and the people that they are praying for. Or maybe you have a prayer chair and a lounge chair that's comfy that you can snuggle up with your coffee, your Bible, and your time with the Lord. Or maybe you are blessed to have a kneel bench. I think Miss Carol has a kneel bench. Oh, but she'd love to have one. Maybe that's where I heard it. But maybe you're blessed to have that. If you do and you want to give one to Carol, she'll take it. Or maybe you're blessed to have an area in your yard where you can go to and just be around the creation that he created to where you can pray without ceasing. Well, about a month ago, I was walking on the treadmill, and I heard the Lord speak to me about my prayer life. You see, there was a time that I was a huge prayer warrior. I prayed a lot, and I prayed for a lot of people. I even had someone give me a charm that said, "Prayer Warrior." People asked me because they knew that I would pray. I enjoyed it, and I loved seeing the fruit of those prayers. Well, since Cameron has passed, and some of you may not know this, but this is Eric and I's son, our youngest. He passed in November of 2019 from complications from a surgery. But since Cam had passed, my passion had not been the same. It wasn't like it once was. Do not get me wrong, I still pray. I don't want you to think your children's pastor here isn't praying. I still pray. But it was different. It was very different. It wasn't ceasing in prayer. I have a prayer room, which is in my home office. This is it at home. And I loved praying in there. I like to lay on the floor before the Lord. I love that window. There's a pillow there that I kneel on. In fact, my pastor, Pastor Dave Catron, came to visit us. And I wanted to show him my prayer room. And when he opened the door, he said, "Valerie, I can feel the presence of the Lord." He knew I was in there praying without ceasing. But what I have realized since the loss of Cam was that it was hard to be praying in there. Lots of memories. I really had begun to lose praying without ceasing. So, as I was walking on the treadmill, the Lord needed to take me down memory lane a bit. And I had really begun to become a grumbler, a complainer, negative. At least I felt so. I had noticed a difference. So here's where the Lord started to jog my memory. Several years ago, and this is where my poor son comes in, I was praising and worshiping the Lord, just focusing all my prayer time on our immediate family. I had a teenager. And I don't know about you, but when I am praying and hearing, I hear the Lord so clearly, and I knew immediately it was God who was speaking to me. And the Lord had said to me, stop focusing all your prayer time on your immediate family and start praying for others. So I went to my dear sweet pastor, Pastor Dave, and I asked him his thoughts because it seemed so crazy to me that the Lord would ask me to stop focusing on my immediate family. But what I realized was this, that was where all my focus was. It wasn't on anyone else. Pastor Dave knew that. And he said to me, Valerie, it looks like the Lord is asking you to focus on some others for a season. He said, write down in a book a list of people that you are praying for. And as God answers those things, just start marking them off. So I went home, I wrote out my list, and I took that list and I started praying over it every day. And number one on my list was a dear friend of mine who we had fallen out of friendship with. And within 2 days, she sent me a text message. I cried. I was so just elated that God would do something so fast. I had just started praying. I was shocked that he would do this. Now, not everything happened that quickly on my list, and not everything on that list is still, like, been written off. It's still there, needing prayer. But another person that I had been praying for to receive Christ for her and her family happened to give me a call and asked if we could go to dinner. We actually went to Panera. And as I sat there, she started sharing with me that she and her family had started going to church. I was so excited because I had been praying for her for probably close to a year. And I told her, I said, oh my word, I've been praying this for you and your family. So I said, I gotta go home because I want you to believe I've written your name in my prayer journal. I have been praying for you. So I went home, I took a picture of it so she could see the date that I had been praying without ceasing for a long time for her. I think it was close to a year. But this is where my love of prayer began. So there on that treadmill, I felt God asking me, are you praying anymore without ceasing? The scripture that instantly came to my mind was 1 Thessalonians 5:17, which says, pray without ceasing. Some translations say pray continually. And I started thinking about how Cam had passed, and was my passion really there, praying without ceasing? As the Lord convicted my heart, I happened to get on Facebook and Instagram that day, and I could see so much division and so much anger on there. And I thought, how can I look on there and be critical at all when I haven't gone back to my prayer room to give what I needed to the Lord? And I knew the Lord was telling me to pray for others again without ceasing. It is His job to do the work by the power of the Holy Spirit. I don't know if you know this or not, but we can't change people. I know we want to, we think we can, and we do because we see things that may need to change in their lives. We can say, if only they would, dot, 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 fill in the blank. But the truth is, only He, our Father in heaven, can change the hearts of those around us. I cannot change my husband as much as I would probably like, and he can't change me as much as he would like. But he can pray, and God can do a work in my heart. And I can pray for him, and God can do a work in his heart. Well, when the Lord puts something on my heart, I tend to dig, and I ponder what it says, what does it mean? And I wanted to know what ceasing looked like. If you remember last time I preached, I told you that when I get a word, I want to go back to its original language. What does it truly mean for that time? What did he say? So I went to my concordance, and I started looking up the words. So what did ceasing mean, and did Jesus do it? Well, this is where your outline begins, and it is different this today. It's on the back of your bulletin instead in the middle. And it said, ceasing means intently and fervently. So ceasing means intently and fervently. Well, that wasn't enough. I needed to dig a little deeper. So intently means fully engaged and determined way that shows strength of purpose. Fervently means with great intensity of spirit, feeling and enthusiasm. So let's say the scripture this way. Pray fully engaged and determined in strength of purpose, with great intensity of spirit, feeling, and enthusiasm. When we know what the word means, what the root, the scripture means, it deepens it, or at least it does for me. It seems so impactful. So let's say it together. Pray fully engaged and determined in strength of purpose, with great intensity of spirit, feeling, and enthusiasm. There is praying without ceasing. I knew the Lord was telling me, you, my daughter, have lost the enthusiasm, the strength of purpose. I was not fully engaged as I once had been. If you know me, you know I do not like to disappoint the Lord. I know I do, but I hate to. Yet I knew he was sad, and I knew that he was convicting me. And the wonderful thing about our Father in heaven is his conviction is for our good. Jesus was missing me, and I was missing him. So, Grace Church, and those of you watching online, what does your prayer life look like? Do you pray while you're doing things around the home, which is okay, by the way? Or do you pray with listening to hear what your Father in heaven has for you? Do you have a special place that you can go to? Or do you simply pray down your checklist? I know me personally, and I was slacking here. I've seen this statement on Instagram a lot, and it really is a convicting little statement. It says, have you prayed about it as much as you've talked about it? Well, that was me. I was frustrated, and when I get frustrated or mad, I tend to get going. And my poor husband, I like to tell him I'm just venting, justifying my actions. But the truth is, if I was to go to another prayer warrior to have him pray with me, that is one thing. But doing it openly just to release my venting was a whole different ballgame. So instead of releasing it to the Lord, I was sharing with my husband most of the time. One of the things that I love about Beth is that when we're talking and I'm sharing with her and we begin to talk too much or she sees me getting upset or frustrated, she stops and she says, we're praying about it right now and we're giving it to the Lord right then and there. What this does is it keeps us from talking about the subject anymore, but it also keeps us from carrying the weight of it ourselves. It's giving it to the Lord and allowing him to do what only he can do. Well, since Beth has left, Brenda and I, we do that. If we're upset about something or frustrated, we go to each other and we stop what we're doing and we pray immediately. We call it the Let's Be Beth. Let's pray. What I know is we must be a church full of prayer warriors. And to those of you watching online, Jesus himself took his heavy burdens to the Lord and asked him to take them. But ultimately, he asked for God's will to be done over his own. I cannot even imagine this. Jesus knew that he was going to be beaten. He knew that he was going to be in pain and humiliation, that he would endure, and yet he asked for God's will to be completed, and not for him to be pain-free and humiliation-free. Jesus prayed without ceasing. In his strength of purpose, of prayer to God, he sweat blood. Now, I would say that's praying intently and fervently. Have we ever prayed like this? Our desire should be as Jesus prayed and to pray as he does. Jesus did not complain to his disciples about what he was getting ready to endure. No. In fact, he told them to stay alert. Stay alert and pray so that the devil does not tempt you. He was worried about them, not himself. He was worried about them. Hear these words from Luke 22, 42 through 46, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. And when he rose from prayer, he came to the disciples, and he found them sleeping for sorrow. And he said to them, Why are you sleeping? Rise and pray, that you may not enter into temptation. Jesus cried out to God, to the one that could change his circumstances. But he was okay if God didn't change his circumstances. Are we, Grace Church, praying with such purpose and agony? Or are we like the disciples and we're sleeping and falling into temptation? I know that me personally, I do not want to be like the disciples. I don't want to be sleeping and falling into temptation. If that has been you, repent and ask God to forgive you for sleeping and start praying without ceasing. I knew that I needed and had to repent. I needed to clean up the prayer area and change it a bit. I had shared with Beth and Sig how hard it was being in that area, but I love that area. And they suggested to change it around a bit and see if that would help. I can say it's still tough, but I am pushing through because I want to be like Jesus and because I love that time with him. It's more bittersweet being in there now. Let me share some more scripture if I have not convinced you yet that we should be a church that is praying without ceasing. In Philippians 4:6, it says, Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. It does not say take some things to God. The Word of God, our life manual, it says take everything to God. And when we take it all to God, I know we will not be anxious about anything. We will not be fearful of death because we know that he gives life and only he can take it away. We will not be fearful of gas prices or food prices or all of the darkness in the world because we're taking those things to the Lord in prayer and trusting in him to provide our every need. When we take everything to God in prayer without ceasing, he is hearing us and doing a work in our hearts. We can be thankful as we see God moving and as we see our lists getting marked off in God's timing. Did you catch that? Not our timing, God's timing. Let me say, this does not mean that we will not have trials. I've had them. What it means is we will walk through those trials way differently because we are praying and we are trusting in the Lord for the outcome, not in man. My last scripture to share is from Acts. And if you've not read this about Peter, I would urge you go to the Word and read it because it is a great testimony to prayer. Peter was kept in prison, but earnest prayer for him was made to God by the church. Acts 12:5. You see, Peter was in prison, but the church didn't sit around and do nothing. They went to the Lord and they gathered together and they prayed. And because they prayed earnestly, the Lord sent an angel and he was released. What this tells me is that we also need to gather together and pray. Pray for others. Pray for things of this world. I want to encourage you to gather with fellow believers and pray together. The word says, where two or more are gathered in my name, there shall I be. We have two times in our own church that you can come and pray and be a part of. But if you can't make those times, I totally understand. But I would say and encourage you, when you're together for Bible study, Sunday school, Hebrew groups, choir practice, anything, children's ministry, gather together and pray. I want to share a video clip from the movie The War Room, where Miss Clara is praying intently and fervently. Take a listen.
You've done it again, Lord. You've done it again. You are good and you are mighty and you are merciful. And you keep taking care of me when I don't deserve it. Praise you, Jesus. You are Lord. Give me another one, Lord. Guide me to who you want me to help. Raise up more that will call upon your name. Raise up those that love you and seek you and trust you. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up. Lord, we need a generation of believers who are not ashamed of the gospel. We need an army of believers, Lord, that hate to be lukewarm and will stand on your word above all else. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up. I pray for unity among those that love you. I pray that you open their eyes so that they can see your truth, Lord. I pray for your hand of protection and guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will take light into this world, that will not compromise when under pressure, that will not cower, Lord, when others fall away. Raise them up, Lord, that they will proclaim that there is salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. Raise up warriors, Lord, who will fight on their knees, who will worship you with their whole hearts, Lord. Lord, call us to battle that we may proclaim you King of kings and Lord of lords. I pray these things with all my heart. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up.
All right, Miss Clara was praying with enthusiasm and passion. She was praying intently, as we should be. She was asking God for more people to mentor and to share how to pray without ceasing. Listen, church, there is a very real enemy out there. His name is the devil. And I know that you know that the world looks dark. The word says he is seeking to kill, steal, and destroy. And he is doing just that. But my question, Grace Church, and for those of you watching online, will you start praying without ceasing? Will you start praying for those you want to see saved and in church? That those God has placed on your heart. If your prayer area is dusty, join me, dust it off. If you don't have a spot, find one. If there are things that you see in your family, in your world, and in your community that is not living for the Lord, that is not honoring his word, will you start praying without ceasing for every one of them, praying fervently and seeing God do what only God can do? May it be so, church. Amen.
Our invitation to the offering this morning comes from Psalm 116, verses 12 through 14. How can I repay the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of his people. Wonderful words. Ushers.
Is sometimes a very simple thing. And the choir anthem for the offertory today reiterates that fact, that we can pray for simple things. One of the things that I've been praying for over the last 10 months since my husband died is joy. And this song asks for something that simple, a three-letter word, joy. And yet, do we pray for that? Do we pray for something in our heart to radiate out to people? We need to look at what we need to pray for, because the change will happen, as Valerie said, but only if we ask for it, and only if we intently and purposefully pray for it. This song is one that you might know. It's not a new song by any means. Some of you may have even learned it in Bible school way back when. And we invite you to sing with us. If you know this song, if you don't, you'll learn it very quickly. It's very simple. The second verse is just women, and the third verse is just men. So raise your voices for the simple gifts. Thank you.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for everything that you provide. Father, your word says you never slumber. You are always caring for us. Lord, I pray that these tithes and offerings will be a blessing to you, that you will use it the way to build the kingdom, Father. We thank you and we praise your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please remain standing as we sing our final hymn, Days of Elijah. And this is a song that really cries for you to sing loud and strong, fervently and intently. Thank you.
Just as deep as gold. Oh God.
Amen, amen, amen. I can't ever listen to that song and not, there was a video clip of some soldiers who were worshiping to that song, and that's what I always see, and they are just worshiping the Lord. So I love that song. So thank you, Miss Arliss. Well, go and be peaceful wherever you are. Be the light of Christ. I pray that God blesses you, keeps you, makes his face to shine upon you. I pray that you find that spot to become that prayer warrior. I pray that you teach it wherever you go. May God bless you and keep you. Amen.